Don't let anybody make you think that God chose America as his divine messianic force to be a sort of policeman of the whole world. God has a way of standing before the nations with judgment, and it seems that I can hear God saying to America, you're too arrogant. And if you don't change your ways, I will rise up and break the backbone of your power.
Oh, tap. This is Femi, here with Freedom Now, and your ears are in tuned at high frequencies in a liberated zone. Freedom Now is a Pan-Africanist, global news outlet from coast to coast, dispelling the Western propaganda media and their all lies point of views. Freedom Now is devoted to relay true news, views, and proper clues to form solutions around freedom for the oppressed worldwide. Now, get relaxed, grab a pen, and phone a friend, because Freedom Now is set to begin to awaken deep sleepers dreaming about freedom now within in Freedom Now in.
Then when we two are apart.
Habari Ghani. This is Sister Thade with Freedom Now's agenda for this Saturday, December 31st, 2022. As some of our listeners wrap up their 2022 Gregorian calendar year today, and others continue this 2022 based on the lunar calendar system, our radical programming here at Freedom Now, we thank all who have donated their time and money to support the station and keep Freedom Now on the air. Today is the last day for the calendar for tax purposes to donate to KPFK for 2022. And so to support Freedom Now, you can go online to kpfk.org and pledge your support and receive your tax write-off while supporting us to bring you more radical programming each week, as long as we can keep the lights on in the building. Right now, you are listening to a sad love song, Wadia Song, written and composed by our beloved comrade and elder brother, Mumia Abu-Jamal, in 2021. As we are greatly saddened to also learn that his wife, Wadia Jamal, made her transition to the ancestor world on December 27th, 2022. Our condolences to all of her relations. We also honor the life of the greatest soccer player of all time, Pele, who made his transition on December 29th, 2022 at the age of 82. He was born in Brazil in 1940 as Edson Arantes do Nascimento. He won various soccer awards during his career and after his career, and his involvement in many humanitarian and peace acts along the way, he helped to rid of corruption in soccer. Pelé transformed the game of soccer with his skills and grace and inspired melanated youth, especially all over the world, to play soccer and fight the racism. Our condolences to all of his relations. For today's program, we commence with our ancestor Didon Kamati in the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar. Then, prolific author, radical historian, professor of African American studies at the University of Houston, and Freedom Now co-producer, Dr. Gerald Horne interviews Jeffrey Oji Ogbar, professor of history at the University of Connecticut and founding director for the Center for the Studies of Popular Music, editor of the book, The Harlem Renaissance Revisited, Politics, Art, and Literature. Then, later in the hour, Dr. Horne interviews Vladimir Alexandrov, B.E. Benzinger, Professor Emeritus of Slavic Languages and Literatures at Yale University, here to discuss his book, The Black Russians. Our music clip mix includes MLK, Zap Mama, Makaya McRaven, Brandy Younger, Roy Hargrove, Gil Evans, The Cookers, and more. So sit back, tell a friend, and as always, we stand ready for revolution.
All our studies, history is best qualified to reward all research. And when you see that you got problems, all you have to do is examine the historic method used all over the world by others who had problems similar to yours. And once you see how they got theirs straight, then you know how you can get yours straight.
Thank you. Lafia. This is Brother Didon with the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar for the week of January 6th. We provide this historical calendar to further enlighten the listening audience on authentic contributions of people of color and a working class to the objective of a classless society rooted in peace, egalitarianism, and self-determination. We urge you to join an organization that's struggling for righteous social change. January 6, 1931, the Scottsboro Boys Trial occurs, where 9 African youth were accused of raping 2 European women. Immortalized by the blues singer Leadbelly, NBC's TV movies, books such as The Killer Mockingbird and Allen Ginsberg, this case drew national attention led by the peoples of Harlem, many of whom were first-generation migrants from the South and later the Communist Party. This case was the first time that black men accused of rape in Alabama were not executed. January 7, 1891, Zora Neale Hurston was born. She got out of a jaywalking ticket once by saying, "I saw white folks crossing on a green light, so I just assumed the red was for me." She was a leading African folklorist, novelist, and the first black woman anthropologist in the United States, who recorded African folk traditions and cultures of the diaspora, especially the United States and in Haiti. Her most notable novel, The Eyes Were Watching God, which contained active female protagonists and used black English as the language of her tales. January 8, 1886, Noble Drew Ali was born. Noble Drew Ali founded the Moorish Science Temples of North America, a continuation of the Islamic traditions in the United States. These Islamic traditions began with the importation of African prisoners of war from Islamic countries of West Africa who had superior agricultural skills for the plantation economy of slavery. Noble Drew Ali's movement gave rise to continued Islamic currents with Mastafard Muhammad, the founder of the Nation of Islam, the largest black nationalist theocratic organization in the United States today. January 8, 1959, the victory of the Socialist Cuban Revolution occurs, smashing the United States and mafia-backed Batista regime and destroying Cuba, being used as an island of sex, drugs, and gambling vices for U.S. tourists. January 9, 1905, the Russian Revolution breaks out in St. Petersburg, where the historical forces of the workers and revolutionary intelligentsia unite to overthrow the Tsarist feudal regime and build the first socialist state in modern times. Here, the working class and peasants, 99% of the population, becomes the rulers, not the capitalist class. The USSR, within 20 years, moved from being one of the poorest nations in Europe to a world power, providing unabated support for the anti-colonial liberation movements of Africa, Asia, and Latin America. January 9, 1912, the African National Congress, the ANC of South Africa, was formed. The ANC is the oldest liberation movement in Africa. 97 years later, the ANC demonstrates that the power of the people is greater than the combination of white settler rule and Western European and U.S. combined support to maintain apartheid. The ANC is the ruling party of South Africa today. The ANC was defined by the U.S. as a terrorist organization, with the U.S. CIA orchestrating the capture and imprisonment of Nelson Mandela. January 9, 1922, Sekou Touré, the Prime Minister of Guinea, who led this former French West African country to independence, was born. The Democratic Party of Guinea, of which Brother Touré was a leader, was the only French-speaking African country to sever all ties to the former colonial master, thereby ensuing French rage. Months before independence, the French military stripped their former colony of electrical, plumbing, dug up the roads, buildings, and all administration, attempting to destroy the infrastructure of Guinea. This was set as an example to all French colonies of the price you pay when you seek total independence as opposed to a commonwealth status with the French. This rape of this country strengthened and fortified the Guinean people, and Sekou Touré as part of the leadership, together with Ghana, the Congo, Mali, Tanzania, Algeria, the list is long, of those revolutionary Pan-African countries who during the 60s fought against U.S. and European imperialism and fought for building an all-African union government, which objectively incorporating 53 African countries into one United States of Africa, thereby providing a massive bulwark against the oppressions of any Africans worldwide and U.S. imperialism. January 10, 1894, the African kinship group known as the Tuareg rise up in armed struggle against the Portuguese in the country of Bissau, which sets the historical antecedent for the rise of Amilcar Cabral and the PAIGC. The Tuareg are a desert Muslim people who have consistently fought in Mali, Niger, Algeria against French colonialism. The Tuareg are an example of the synchronization of Islam and traditional African values and culture. For instance, women in the Tuareg society have a strong and free position, and she decides over her own life. Men, not women, wear veils over their face in public. Women play a dominant role in their society where there is a matrilineal descent pattern. January 10, 1860, Henrietta Vinton Davis was born. She was an actress, teacher, and a Universal Negro Improvement Association and African Communities League leader. UNIA and ACL was the largest mass organization of African people in any country and any historical period in humankind history. She founded the Black Theater Company and was a director of the Black Star Shipping Line, a remarkable achievement in the era of segregation. January 10, 1864, George Washington Carver was born. Brother Carver, under a segregated U.S., was a scientist, botanist, inventor, and educator who revolutionized agriculture in the U.S. by his promotion of alternative crops to cotton, including the peanut and sweet potato, thereby increasing the quality of the soil through rotation. He invented over 100 products to be used from peanuts, including cosmetics, dyes, paints, plastic, gasoline, and nitroglycerin. His work destroyed the widespread stereotype that blacks were intellectually inferior to whites. January 11, 1959, the contemporary movement for the independence of Puerto Rico was launched as Puerto Ricans grow weary of the colonized status within the U.S. empire. January 11, 1965, poet Lorraine Hansberry, author and dramatist, dies. Her works include Raising in the Sun and To Be Young, Gifted and Black. Her themes include anti-racism, women's rights, and African liberation from colonialism. This has been the African Drumbeat Historical Calendar here at Freedom Now, 90.7 FM in Southern California and 98.7 FM in Santa Barbara.
This is Gerald Horne for KPFK, kpfk.org, and with me on the line is Jeffrey O.G. Ogbar, professor of history and founding director of the Center for the Study of Popular Music at the University of Connecticut, and editor of the book, The Harlem Renaissance Revisited, Politics, Arts, and Literature. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Professor Ogbar.
It's an absolute pleasure to be here, Dr. Horne. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for joining us. So why did you produce this book, and tell our audience what was the Harlem Renaissance anyway?
So in at the University of Connecticut, we had a conference on the Harlem Renaissance in 2008, and it was a wonderful event. We had presenters actually from around the world. We had people come in from Europe, from Canada, throughout the United States. We had a one-woman show, Spike Lee, Amiri Baraka. It was really a wonderful, just outstanding event. And I decided to see if we could publish a book from it. And so I put a call out. I edited the book. We had a number of really talented contributors. And the book really built upon the work of the conference, where we wanted to broaden the meaning and the interrogation of the Harlem Renaissance. And the Harlem Renaissance itself is defined generally as an explosion of African-American art, artistic expression, intellectual work, political expression. And when I say artistic, music, visual, sculptures, plays, novels, poets, you have so many different things centered in but not exclusive to New York. And at the time, what we call the interwar years, so largely between, say, 1919 and the Great Depression, so in the 1930s, mid-1930s or so, So that's really what the Harlem Renaissance is generally understood as, in a very, very conventional sense. It's been broadened in the last few years. Historians have sort of, some have attempted to walk away from the term Harlem Renaissance and use New Negro Renaissance as a better representation of what was going on, to sort of decentering Harlem. But that's essentially what the Harlem Renaissance is. And the book actually does decenter Harlem as well, although we use a conventional definition, the conventional nomenclature, Harlem Renaissance.
So you've also written a book on Black power. And how do you distinguish the Black arts movement of the 1960s congruent with the rise of Black power from the Harlem Renaissance?
Excellent question, because if I can for a second, Alain Locke was a philosopher, chair of the philosophy department at Howard University, brilliant philosopher, and he's the one, sort of the dean of the Harlem Renaissance, people will call him. And he published a book, The New Negro, in the mid-1920s, and many people use the term New Negro Movement. But when Alain Locke may have talked about a New Negro Renaissance, he said that this was not something that is an ephemeral expression of just the 1920s, not just the decade, but something that he actually said that it's like a small town that is on its way to becoming a big city. That's how he envisioned what we saw in the 1920s. And so if you take Alain Locke's definition of that explosion of political, artistic, cultural work in the 1920s as a small town, then what we see by the 1960s is the rapid expansion of that town, right? And so by the Black arts movement, we see an explosion of Black artistic expression, but many of the artists like Haki Madhubuti and Amiri Brock and others, Nikki Giovanni and Sonia Sanchez, these are the big names, they saw themselves as distinct from their predecessors two generations earlier and thought themselves generally as a bolder expression of Blackness, right? But you gotta keep in mind, the people in the 1920s thought themselves to be a bolder expression of Blackness than generations prior, right? And so every generation seems to think themselves to be a bolder, more sort of capacious, unfettered expression of Blackness, if you will. And I think that the Black arts movement itself really builds upon, you know, the artistic work that you found in the 1920s.
Mm-hmm. So you've also published a book on hip hop. How would you compare the conditions that created hip hop with the conditions that created the Harlem Renaissance?
Interesting that New York City is central to both of those. You know, the Harlem Renaissance, of course, being centered in New York, hip hop itself coming out of New York as well, some 50 years later. And it's kind of interesting to say that now, because we're 50 years from hip-hop's creation, and hip-hop was 50 years from the Harlem Renaissance. So we kind of think about that in those ways. It is kind of fascinating how close or how far we are to these historical moments. But I think that you have a Black community in the urban center, and in many ways, socioeconomically, politically isolated. I think that with hip-hop, unlike the Harlem Renaissance, there was a particular subaltern. I know that's a fancy academic word, but hip hop was unattached to the mainstream institutions that typically gave people like Zora Neale Hurston, authors like Zora Neale Hurston and Langston Hughes, or you know, so many other authors of the 1920s, they're sort of bona fides, right? They were sort of anchored in major institutional spaces, when hip hop wasn't. I mean, hip hop came from the margins and actually boldly did things on its own terms and didn't really seek, when, you know, the mainstream, to quote Jay-Z, we didn't go to the mainstream came to us. And so hip hop really was central about being on our own terms. And so for the first few years of hip hop, you know, like there were artists that came out. There were no hip hop magazines, no radio stations. A lot of radio stations didn't play hip hop. Hip hop DJs played in parks. Break dancers played in, you know, they performed in parks and on, you know, subways or cardboard. And it was a very sort of, and, you know, graffiti writers were, you know, writing on walls. So a lot of it was very sort of underground, if you will. And the mainstream starts to pay attention to it. And then, you know, you have this sort of explosion of it as well later. And I think that hip hop itself, unlike the Harlem Renaissance or Black Arts Movement, hip-hop has sustained itself in a very different fashion than these other two cultural expressions. And I think that hip-hop has been, over the last 50 years, it's matured and it's grown in ways that no artistic art form, white or black people have ever created, has grown. I mean, it's had a global imprint in a way that rock and roll, European classical, jazz, blues, gospel, they have not, that these other genres have not had. And I think in the United States, whether we're talking about movies or fashion or all sorts of other things, like hip hop has really had an imprint that's been quite broad. And in many ways, kind of aligned with the cultural expressions that we might see in these other two movements, but also very different.
Now, speaking of which, as you were talking, I'm thinking of Marcus Garvey and the role his movement played in the Harlem Renaissance. And could you speak to that? And also, I guess that leads inevitably to a comparison with the role that Black power and Black nationalism plays in the Black arts movement. And then I wonder if there was any sort of comparable political movement that accompanied hip hop. I know that's a compound question, but I'm sure you can sort it out.
Yeah, great question. So I think that when you look at these historical movements and we say, hey, there's a lot of expression here. There's an explosion of expression. When you think about that explosion of expression, invariably you're going to have a political component. And Paul Robeson would say that all art is political, whether we want it to be or not, and particularly Black art. And that if Black people are creating art, and this is a debate of the 1920s, right? Langston Hughes and Du Bois and others had this debate. If Black artists were beholden to having some polemics in their art, should they, you know, be very conscious of, you know, saying something political? But beyond the sort of expression we might find in plays or poems or novels, there was, outside of that, this Black nationalist movement with UNIA, Universal Negro Improvement Association. And I think that Garvey captured the zeitgeist in many ways of African Americans who had come back from the war or had relatives that were in the Great War and had the rhetoric, the very sort of explicit celebration of freedom and democracy, that you were to kill and die for freedom and democracy. Yet your uncles, your fathers, your sons, your brothers, you come back home and you cannot take your wife to a hospital to give birth, right? You can't vote, you can't serve on a jury, you can't run for office, you can't be dog catcher. You know, you can't even determine who the dog catcher is, let alone president. And so I think that Marcus Garvey touched, struck a chord with many African Americans, the idea that Black people should do for themselves and so on and create their own country. I think when you get to the Black arts movement, there is the political component, which runs along conterminously with artistic expressions. But the political component, as you know, is not monolithic, it's quite varied. So you have all sorts of politics. You have this in the 1920s as well, but you have this explosion of ideological diversity. I mean, you have people who are not just Black nationalists in the Nation of Islam, but you have the African Descendants Independent Party, these small nationalist organizations across the United States. You have self-defined revolutionary nationalist organizations, the Revolutionary Action Movement, the Black Panther Party. You have the Republic of New Africa. So you have Black nationalists, but all sorts of different types of Black nationalists in the 1960s. And then you have people who are integrationists, and they're not all the same. You know, some integrationists believe in going through the court system, and they also believe in having guns. And you have people who are activists who do not eschew guns. So I think when you get to hip hop, in a similar way, you have ideological diversity in the Black community, but because hip hop has had a much longer sort of stretch. I mean, we're talking about 50 years now, and really about 30, over 30 years of centrality in pop music. I mean, so now you're looking at, I mean, hip hop was, you had platinum albums in the 1980s and winning Grammys in the late 1980s. And so now you're talking about a good 30 years of hip hop being really central. So there was a moment in hip hop when Black nationalism was really big in the early 1990s, in the late 1980s. And so I've had friends say that the first time they ever heard Malcolm X's voice was when it was sampled in a hip hop song. And there were all sorts of people who never even knew what Malcolm sounded like, were just, they saw the name written somewhere, but had never, you know, never had known much about what Malcolm believed in. And it was sort of distilled and reduced to these, you know, little snippets here and there, but the sort of the iconography of Black Power, of the Nation of Islam in particular, and the Black Panther Party, a lot of that came up in the 1990s, early 1990s, late 1980s. So you did have a moment of some sort where you had that, but not a real political movement in the way you might have had with the 60s and 20s.
Mm-hmm. Now, back to the Harlem Renaissance. So who was Duke Ellington, and what role does he play in your book?
So Duke Ellington is from Washington, D.C., and most African-Americans in the 1920s were poor. Duke Ellington was middle class and not wealthy, but comfortable. And he decided to get into music to the chagrin of his parents, and was a great pianist. And really at the tail end of the Harlem Renaissance, you know, he was a big band leader. He was a brilliant, charismatic, stylish composer and performer. And Duke Ellington would emerge as, over the course of several decades, one of the most, if not the most, celebrated American composer of all time, you know. And then he would do scores for movies. And this is a Black man, right? With white Hollywood giving very little opportunity to Black folks to do anything. And then he was just a marvelous performer all around the country with his band and adoring crowds. And he, in some ways, Duke Ellington was, for some folks, an anti-minstrel, meaning that the image that many people, most Americans, saw of Black people by 1925, most images that Americans saw of Black people in pop culture were servile, comical, clueless, feckless, idiotic, childlike, grown Black men who were often described as really unattractive and, if not, grotesque. And in the case, there were no examples for them to see Black folks otherwise, right? Like white Americans weren't reading novels from anybody. The vast majority of white Americans were not reading novels from Langston Hughes or anyone else, sort of Hurston or Jesse Fawcett. They were not actually, weren't like there were Black folks in movies that did not appear in these servile ways. Oscar Michaud was a Black filmmaker, but whites weren't standing in line to see Oscar Michaud movies. There were no Black folks in professional sports, right, for whites to see. So unless they went out of their way to go to a Black professional sport, they saw no Black people at all play baseball, football, basketball, any sport, right? So Black people were absent, except as these characters that were these feckless, ignorant, irresponsible, childlike miscreants. And then there was Duke Ellington, this one space. Music. There's one space where whites would actually watch Black people where they were not performing to a white script. And Duke Ellington was industrious, a genius. If one ever refers to a musical genius, he would have to qualify. He was elegant. He was sophisticated. He was charming. He ran his big band. He was wildly accomplished. And so in many ways, people see him as a sort of an anti-minstrel figure. And in his own way, although he was not very explicit about his politics, you know, that was a political act, one might say.
Finally, Professor Ogbar, Professor of History and Founding Director of the Center for the Study of Popular Music at the University of Connecticut, editor of the book, The Harlem Renaissance Revisited, Politics, Arts, and Literature. Another compound question. What next for your research and writing agenda? What advice do you provide to the next Professor Ogbar? And talk to us about your ties to Los Angeles.
All right. Okay, so what next? I have a book that's in the final stages of production called America's Black Capital, How African Americans Remade Atlanta in the Shadow of the Confederacy. And it's a sweeping history of Atlanta from the Civil War to the present, looking at the ways in which the Confederacy itself sort of embedded itself in the social, cultural, and political fabric of the city of Atlanta over these decades, over 100 plus years, and how African Americans navigated their presence in the city, and in a very ironic way, did things that African Americans in no other city did, and including From best of my knowledge, and you're a historian, so I'd love to see if you can help answer my question, my research. It looks like they have the very first black amusement park in the United States around 1921. They create Joyland Park, but you also have these black suburban developments. And by the 1950s, they have the largest black suburban development in the United States of America. Black developers, designers, construction teams. It's really fascinating. Banks that fund this. And you have some of the wealthiest black insurance companies. You have the highest concentration of black colleges and universities. You have black realtors, of course, black churches, like many other cities. The only black daily newspaper. So even when Harlem is seen as a veritable capital for black America, black people in the 1920s are about in Harlem, excuse me, in New York City, they're under 10%. They may be somewhere around 5% of the city of New York. So black folks are like single digit percentages in most northern cities, in Philadelphia, Chicago, Boston, New York, they're around between like 2-7%. Atlanta, they're a third, right? So there's some significant percentage of the population. And they also have a very, very significant influence in the shaping of the city in so many different ways. So the book really kind of explores that. The advice for someone who is interested in engaging in history, I really say is that be passionate about it. If you find a passion, I think history is a discipline that allows you to pursue so much that there's almost like sounds cliche to say it's an open book, but if you're curious about something, like African Americans and Mexican Revolution, no one's written on it. Why not I? And it's really kind of cool that you can actually write a book and carve out and add to the corpus of knowledge that we have about a particular historical moment or historical phenomena. And it's really exciting to be able to make those contributions. You know, and I've loved Atlanta. I did my undergrad there, and I remember landing in Atlanta in 1987 for college, and at the airport seeing a picture of the executive at the airport and seeing it was a black person. And I was struck by that. And, you know, in LAX, we had a black mayor, like Atlanta did, and Chicago had a black mayor at the time. So having a black mayor wasn't that special, but that the executive at the airport, LAX and O'Hare, as far as I knew, did not have black executives. But that was the beginning of my awe. And Atlanta's not perfect. I mean, Atlanta's all sorts of problems, and even as it has all these successes. But I like to explore those things and the complications. And my passion, my love for the city, led to my passion in exploring its history. So I would say that, and the same thing for Black Power, same thing for hip hop. I loved hip hop from far back as I can remember, from Rapper's Delight. I was a hip hop fan. I just knew rap as one of the four elements of hip hop, but I was a fan from 9 years old, right, all the way up. And as someone who would be in the barbershop or hanging out with my friends debating why your top five is your top five, and then having the professional tools to explore this, I mean, it was just a gift. I love that. I love being able to pursue that. My connections to LA, I was born in Chicago and raised in LA. So I finished first grade in Compton, California, and then second grade through 12th grade in the LA Unified School District. And we moved around a whole lot in LA. We lived and moved twice in Compton. Then we moved to South Central LA and the South Park area. And in South Central, then we moved up to Slauson, like Vermont Slauson area, then Mid City, and then South Wilshire. So I moved about 8 or 9 times in the city of LA, but always in LA. And sometimes I meet people and they say they're from LA, and I ask them, they're like from way out of San Bernardino or Barstow or something, you know. Not really from LA. I'm really from LA.
So what high school did you go to?
I went to Sherman Oaks Center for Enriched Studies in as a magnet school in the Valley.
I did.
And we moved around a lot, so I guess I would have gone to a lot of different high schools, but Manual Arts over in Vermont would have been one of the schools. LA High would have been another school where I went. I went to LA High for the summer one year. Mm-hmm. And then Wilshire, the district for Fairfax was on the other side of Hauser. And so in my neighborhood, there were people who went to LA High, and then just across the street, people went to Fairfax by the time I graduated high school.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there, Professor Jeffrey O.G. Ogbar, Professor of History and Founding Director of the Center for the Study of Popular Music at the University of Connecticut, editor of the book, The Harlem Renaissance Revisited, Politics, Arts, and Literature. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK, Los Angeles.
Thank you very much. Absolute pleasure being here.
Thank you.
This is Sister Flora, and you are listening to Freedom Now at KPFK 90.7 FM in occupied Mexico, including Los Angeles, 98.7 FM Santa Barbara, 93.7 FM in San Diego, and streaming live on the web at kpfk.org. Today's program, as well as 10 prior editions, can be reheard at kpfk.org/audio archive, and scroll down to Freedom Now. From 12 to 1 p.m., following Freedom Now is their sister Asunta, with Spotlight Africa addressing issues facing Mother Africa. For a truly alternative international perspective on world affairs, check out RTTV Russia, CCTV China, and online at Presna, Latina Cuba Telesur Venezuela, News 24, South Africa, and Press TV Iran. We will now continue with historian professor Dr. Gerald Horne.
This is Gerald Horne for KPFK, kpfk.org, and with me on the line is Vladimir Alexandrov, B.E. Bensinger Professor of Slavic Languages and Literature at Yale University in Connecticut, and author of the book, The Black Russian. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK Los Angeles, Professor Alexandrov.
Thank you very much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
And it's a pleasure to have you. So who was Frederick Bruce Thomas, and why did you decide to write a book about him?
He was an absolutely remarkable man. He was the son of former slaves in Mississippi, born in Cahoma County in the Deep South in 1872, who led a remarkable life by leaving the South long before Black people began to migrate to the North in large numbers. Then he left the United States for Europe long before Black people began to expatriate themselves. Then he went to Russia, a country where there were hardly any Black people at all, for reasons that we can talk about in a minute or later. And there he became a multimillionaire impresario in Tsarist Moscow. He ran nightclubs and theaters that are extremely successful. When he lost everything in Russia during the Russian Revolution, he reinvented himself yet again in Constantinople, what Istanbul used to be called. He became rich and popular there as well. So with a life trajectory like that, when I started digging into it, I became so fascinated that I decided I have to try to learn as much as I can and write his story so that other people would know.
So I take it that he left the United States for Europe because of an unpleasant experiences in the United States of America. Is that a fair inference?
It is. He left the South hoping to have better opportunities in the North. He lived and worked in Chicago and Brooklyn, but he still ran up against the color line, specifically when he was trying to advance his career in music. He had an emigre German teacher in New York City who told him that he would never be allowed to get into a conservatory in the United States, and suggested that he, Thomas, go to Europe for this purpose. So Thomas simply got on a boat. It was very easy to travel in those days. He didn't even need a passport, and went to England. Now, he didn't actually pursue a musical career there for reasons that are not entirely clear. I suspect it's because he decided he didn't want to. I say that because he was such a determined man in terms of pursuing the things that he was really interested in, that had he wanted to be a musician of some sort, he could have done it. But he relied on the skills he had picked up in the North when he was working in Chicago and Brooklyn, which were being a waiter and a valet. And he was extremely good at this. He worked at some of the best places in the United States when he was doing this. And he pursued that career successfully all over Europe, traveling from London to Paris to Germany to Monte Carlo and eventually to Russia.
Now, speaking of pre-1917 Russia, pre-revolutionary Russia, were there other Black Americans
in that country at that moment?
There were very few. I remember looking into this specifically, and my estimate is that around 1900, 1910, Thomas got to Moscow around 1900, in a city with a population of something like 1.3 million, there might have been a dozen or two dozen black people total. Most of them were Americans, and most of them worked in the horse racing industry and sport, which was very popular. One is quite famous. There have been a couple of books written about him. James, or as he was known, Jimmy Wingfield. He was a famous jockey who won the Kentucky Derby at the beginning of the 20th century and then hit the color line. There was no future for him in horse racing despite his success as a jockey. So he wound up going to Russia, where he did extremely well, winning some of the biggest races and some of the biggest purses. So there were people like that. There were also black people who passed through as entertainers when they were going on tours of Europe in those days, going to St. Petersburg, Moscow, Kiev, was part of a European tour for performers of different kinds. But that's pretty much it. As I said, black people were very rare in Russia for historical and geographical reasons. The Russians didn't try to colonize Africa or Asia, for that matter, except for the countries and territories that were contiguous with the Russian Empire, whereas the Europeans did. I mean, it's hardly a country you can think of in Western Europe that did not try to have colonies in either Africa or Asia. So in that sense, there was no kind of source for black people to be coming to Russia from Africa, from the Caribbean, or the United States. So he was very rare. But the thing that he noticed is that nobody seemed to mind. He didn't signal anything to the locals. Claude McKay, the famous black American poet who went to Soviet Russia in the early 1920s, found the same thing when he went there. This is after the revolution, of course. He wrote very interesting articles about his experience, and he mentioned in them that some of the Russian poets that he was dealing with would ask him, why do you keep raising the race issue? I mean, there are people in the former Russian Empire, in the new Soviet Union, whose skin is darker than yours. They came from Central Asia and places like that. They cared, they told him, Claude McKay, only about your poetry, not your skin color. So this is the kind of attitude that Thomas also encountered, which allowed him to prosper in the way that he did, because he was very good at the kind of entrepreneurship that he wanted to pursue, beginning first working in restaurants as he had before, then rising in the ranks to becoming a maître d'hôtel and an assistant to the owner of one of the fanciest restaurants in the entire Russian Empire. And then eventually, with some Russian partners, they pooled their money together and opened a place of their own. And then he opened another place of his own. So he became a multimillionaire by the time that the First World War rolled around in 1914.
Now, continuing on this contextual point of black people in Russia, who was Pushkin? And how does his life serve as a possible key to unlocking Mr. Thomas's experience in Russia?
Yeah, Pushkin is Russia's national poet. He was born in 1799, died in 1837. One of the interesting things about him is that his great-grandfather was an African, thought to be, by some researchers, the details on this are not entirely clear, to have been an Ethiopian nobleman. He had been bought in the slave market of Constantinople by the Russian envoy to Constantinople, who brought him back with him to Russia and gave him to the emperor, Peter I. But Peter I was, in many ways, an enlightened man. He adopted this young African man who had been bought in Constantinople and sent him to France for military education. And when the young man came back and he was named Abram Hannibal, he became a military officer in the Russian army and rose to the rank of general. Now, the thing about him is that when I first started researching Thomas and talking to people who know something about Russian history and culture, and I would mention Thomas to them, everybody was very surprised that such a person had existed in Imperial Russia, because the only black person who left any kind of a mark in Russian culture and history that people in general know about is Abram Hannibal, or Abraham Hannibal. It underscores the rarity of people from either Africa, the Caribbean, or the US, black people, in the Russian Empire. I mean, as I mentioned, Pushkin was a descendant of the African. He died in the beginning of the 19th century. It means that from the beginning of the 18th century to the end of the 20th century, toward the end of the 19th century, in other words, for a period of almost 200 years, there were hardly any black people in Russia that are known to people who study the country in the period, except for Pushkin. And Pushkin's ancestors' ability to succeed in the Russian system, again, without being discriminated against because of his skin color, does prefigure what happened with Thomas 75 years later when he arrived.
Now, is it fair to suggest that Pushkin is celebrated in Russia because of his contributions to the Russian language and to Russian literature?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he, and when I said that he's a national poet, he's as important in Russian culture as I don't know who, as Goethe in German, Shakespeare in English. Of course, Pushkin was closer to us in time, but his revisions of the Russian language, his contributions to lyrical poetry, to narrative poetry, to drama, and to prose are among the greatest works of Russian letters of all time. This is not a point on which there is much divergence of opinion. He is the gold reserve of Russian literary culture to this day. And that's not likely to change, given that he's already been in that state for a long time.
Now, you say that the subject of your book, The Black Russian, speaking of Frederick Bruce Thomas, he wound up in Turkey. Are you able to share any insight on the Black experience in Turkey during the time that Mr. Thomas was there?
Yes, and it's actually a very interesting matter, because if we look at what happened with Thomas by leaving the United States, going to Western Europe, then going to Russia, and then to Turkey, we see the varieties of perceptions of Blackness that existed in those different places at that time, the end of the 19th, the beginning of the 20th century. About American racism, we don't need to speak. We know about that. Western Europe, interestingly enough, was very receptive to black people at that time. I mean, for example, at the same time that Frederick arrived and was working in France and Germany, the well-known Ida Wells came from Nashville, from Memphis, where she had been an activist, to England to help agitate among the British against the crime of lynching going on in the United States. And the British listened to her. The British were racists, but not with regard to black people at that time. They used or saved their racist attitudes for Jews and South Asians, for example. In Germany, the situation was a bit more complicated. It wasn't as if black people were simply not marked as being different at all. They were to some extent. In France, the reception of black people was a positive one in general at that time. About Russia, we already spoke. They had very little experience with any people whose skin was black. And so Thomas's skin was not marked. Turkey was yet another matter. In Ottoman Turkish society, under the Sultans, a person was identified not by race, but by religious affiliation. The important thing was to be a Muslim. But the Ottoman Empire was relatively tolerant of other religious confessions. Christians and Jews were able to live happily in the Ottoman Empire and to thrive. So when Thomas arrived in Turkey, from a Turk's point of view, the fact that he was black did not signify. What did signify is that he wasn't a Muslim, but there was tolerance towards non-Muslims. The problem for Thomas was that he arrived in Turkey in 1919. Turkey had allied itself with the Central Powers during the First World War, Germany, Austro-Hungary, and the Central Powers lost. So in 1918, shortly after the armistice was signed, European warships arrived in large numbers in the Bosphorus and anchored off the shore of Constantinople, and thousands of French, Italian, British, and American soldiers and sailors went on shore and started taking over. Thomas had to deal with the Americans because he had been an American himself. And that's where American racism surfaced again, thousands of miles away from the United States, and where it harmed Thomas when he had to deal with Americans trying to be represented and trying to get legal protection from them. So the construction of race varied very differently depending on where Thomas was during his life. But as I said, the inherent Turkish attitude toward blackness was an open and accepting one. I mean, as late as the 1960s, black American writers who went to visit and to live in Turkey discovered that the Turkish language did not even have a specific term that was as loaded as the N-word, even in the polite form, is in English. They used to refer to people with black skin as Arab, meaning Arab. Now, you see what I'm getting at. It's not a specific term for people of African descent, no matter how they may have gotten to where they were seen.
Now, what about the music we call jazz? What was Thomas's relationship to that music?
Thomas was very much interested in doing or in acquiring for his venues where performers performed, sang, danced, and so on, whatever was new and popular. He kept track of this when he was in Moscow. As a theater owner, he did the same thing in Constantinople in his nightclub. He got wind of the fact that a new kind of music had arrived in Europe. He read newspapers, he knew about what was going on. And so he introduced jazz to Turkey, the first person to do it, in 1919, which was very early. Jazz was taking over the world, but he managed to get it to Turkey before anyone else, and it immediately took root. The traditions of Turkish jazz, which is still very popular and which underwent its own metamorphoses, can be traced to Thomas's bringing it there in 1919. And there are scholars of jazz in Turkey who know this. So Thomas is to some extent remembered in Istanbul because of this contribution.
Now, are there Thomas descendants still living in Russia or Turkey or France or the United States for that matter?
I met Thomas's grandson in Paris when I started researching my book. It's now about 10 years ago that this was. Very forthcoming man, very helpful, very hospitable, who told me what he knew about his grandfather after expressing surprise that I would surface in his life asking about him, because Thomas was virtually forgotten by the time I started looking into his life. I was not able to find any relatives in the American South, although I tried in Cahoma County and more broadly. I found out after my book came out that Thomas had another daughter that I did not know about. His marital situation was complicated, but to make a long story short, he had a daughter by a woman in Moscow who was not his wife. And the daughter stayed with the mother's family when Thomas had to flee the Bolsheviks in 1918. That woman became an artist, quite a successful one. Her works were collected. She died maybe in something like 1993, according to the person who wrote to me about her and who sent me a photograph of Thomas that had been in his family's collection because their great-grandfather had been involved in business with Thomas, you know, virtually a century earlier. There are some other distant relatives in Luxembourg, for example, that I was able to find out about, but none of them really knew much about their ancestor before my book came out.
Finally, Professor, are there any other topics concerning Black Americans in Russia that you can suggest for the budding scholars in our audience?
Well, you know, one very fertile field that people have been working on for a long time, but that I don't think has been exhausted, is the issue of Black Americans, for one, or Black people in general, going to Russia during the Soviet period of its history. I mentioned Claude McKay. He was one of the early ones. Other members of the Harlem Renaissance also visited the early Soviet Russia because they wanted to see what colorblind, supposedly democratic society was like. We know that some of the promise of the Soviet system, the sort that appealed to them, was not in fact realized. But Russia also opened its doors to students from the Third World, as it used to be called, in the 60s. There was a university founded in Moscow called People's Friendship University. No, it was named after Patrice Lumumba, the figure from the Congolese history. And hundreds, if not thousands, of African Asian students came to Moscow to study. Of course, the Soviet Union was interested in indoctrinating them as well, but they went home having learned technical skills, nursing, medicine, and so on. So between the various Americans who went, I mean, Paul Robeson is a very well-known figure who went to the Soviet Union more than once, and there were others. I think something in that area, because there were so many people going under such different circumstances, that one might find something to work on. I haven't come up with anything before Thomas, who arrived, as we've been talking about, at around 1900, and left for the south of Russia in 1918 and went to Turkey in 1919. There were some people, Black people, who passed through, but who didn't seem to leave much of a mark. So perhaps the Soviet period would be the richest one to try to mine.
Well, I'm afraid we're going to have to leave it there, Professor Alexandrov, B.E. Benzinger, Professor of Slavic Languages and Literature at Yale University in Connecticut, and author of the book, The Black Russian. Thank you for joining us on Freedom Now, KPFK, Los Angeles.
Thank you, Professor Horne.
And in closing, we'd like to thank our guests, Jeffrey O.G. Ogbar, Vladimir Alexandrov, our co-producers, Dr. Gerald Horne, Brother Brandon Sankara, Sister Flora, Sister Femi, our board op, and all those who made today's program possible. Please stay tuned for our Sister Asumpta coming up next with Spotlight Africa, addressing issues facing Mother Africa. This program, as well as prior programs, can be reheard for the next 60 days. You can go to kpfk.org, audio archives, scroll to Freedom Now. And until next Saturday, signing off for Freedom Now, this is Sister Thage. As always, we stand ready for revolution.